Teresa is an architect and architectural theorist, and lectures in history and theory studies at the Architectural Association in London. She's the editor of the Journal of Architecture, and is the founder of an organization called This Thing Called History, which I'm going to read, is an international independent research collective that aims to investigate and redefine the role of theory in architecture and to practice it collectively and in different forms. So the talk tonight is going to be very much about theory and urbanism, and she's written a number of books that focus on theory and urbanism. One in particular that we were talking about, she's written a book about Manhattan and Venice as paradigm islands. And she's also written The Unorthodox Ways to Think the City in 2018, which is her most recent book, yes? Mm-hmm. And so the title tonight is based on the book, Unorthodox Architecture as Paradigm. Yes. So thank you very much.
And thank you for
having me.
Okay. What I'm going to do today is really go through different ideas of trade paradigm and try and break it apart, starting from the city, going away from the city and from architecture, and then eventually going back to architecture. No need to hide it. The idea is that the redefinition of the term paradigm can help us understand the making of the project in architecture, especially in architecture in context and in the city. I'm orthodox because it questions words which are usually familiar and very easily used in our discipline, and because it aims to make produce a pause to rethink these words. This quote from George Agamben, who writes about paradigm, especially in relation to philosophy, can work as a starting point. Paradigm actually presupposes the impossibility of the rule, and I guess the idea of the impossibility of the rule will be the guiding thread today in my talk. So the key question for me to start these considerations is it possible then to propose that the relational operation that the project of architecture performs in the city is paradigmatic, and that the work of architecture in general is paradigm. And in order to do this and to address this question, the paradigm needs to be redefined as an operation. And the work of the paradigm must be considered as a cultural operation, as it produces a non-dialectical form of knowledge, a knowledge that acts in the environment without aiming to achieve the universal and to derive principles and therefore rules from it. What I aim to do is to propose that architecture's nature is in itself paradigmatic in the way it establishes and maintains a series of relations in order to be and to change. Agamben starts and resorts to the Platonic argument. Platonic argument is rigid because it's biased towards the existence of an ideal, but it provides an interesting opening because it suggests the possibility to consider the paradigm as an element of mediation between opposites of the dialectical process. Then the confrontation no longer happens in the opposition of two, but it takes place, literally takes place, in the space of negotiation. The space of negotiation is what Plato interestingly calls measure. And it needs to be reconsidered here, not in relation to an aspiration to the ideal, but as a place, as a locus of negotiation, a sort of a cloud of instances, an idea in the midst, I would say, that is not in the middle but moves in between. And is the in between where architecture operates. It's through questioning, but also appropriating the idea of the scientific paradigm, especially as defined by Thomas Kuhn, analyzing the linguistic anti-paradigm proposed by Roland Barthes in his definition, or rather approximation of the neutral, and embracing the philosophical argument for a reconsideration and redefinition of the paradigm as suggested by George Agamben, that perhaps we can come to propose the idea of architecture as a paradigm. Architecture as paradigm can be proposed, in fact, only through a paradigm approach, through doing it to the idea of the paradigm. Pushing it and working the space in between, and in this case, the space in between science, philosophy, linguistics, to then come to architecture. But to rename and eventually return to architecture, we need to start from its context par excellence and therefore consider the situation. Contrary to the reductive common usage of the term paradigm, looking at the ancient Greek etymology, paradigma, means example, exemplar. But it is a relation word that contains within itself the possibility of variation and movement. Paradigm contains the root paradèigma, to show, to compare. Deeply meant to show, to indicate, is itself relational. It establishes a three-way dynamics between a subject who shows or indicates, a subject who is shown to, and an object, let's call it model for the time being, that is shown. So in this relation, though, the object is active too, and it is important not for the way it looks or sounds, depending on what the object may be, but for the way in which it has been activated in this relation. It is also active because it continues to both make itself and change itself. And so the combination of the relational dignité with the comparative para in the making of paradigm is a farther complication that activates this relation. It indicates the possible continuation of a regulated action, but also a distancing from it, and the production of a difference or a shift, which, just to anticipate where I'm heading, is the space opened up for the making of the project. So the paradigm is not an object. It's doubly relational. It indicates a modus operandi, and so rather than an object or a fixed example or a result or, to achieve or a requirement to fulfill, is a way of working and relating. It is an action. It contains within itself the possibility of variation and movement. It indicates oscillation and multiplicity rather than fixity and oneness. And because it shifts, it almost slips away from the object example, it opens up, it's dynamic, it's subject to change, and therefore open to heterogeneity. And that is particularly relevant in architecture, in the city or urban architecture. So the paradigm uses models, but is not a model. As an example, it is a performative one, and its complexity must be unfolded in relation to the work of the project. As an intellectual operation, it produces a distance, and that is the crucial first step in the paradigm as a process. A distance of the object from itself, it removes the object from its singularity to then return it to another singularity. We'll see examples of this. It also enables a distancing from acquired historical, morphological, typological preconceptions and classifications that are well known in architecture and urbanism. And in this sense, the notion of the paradigm, the operation of the paradigm, can perhaps illuminate the operation of the architectural project. The paradigm is what I would call a shifty model. And so, not a model that can be imitated without engaging in the production of a difference from it. And of course, that is where the project, as we know it, as action, decision, production of a discontinuity, resides. If we look at the dictionary definition of paradigm, even beyond the etymology, in a way, we find confirmation of this take on the word. The paradigm in the philosophy of science, and I'm quoting, indicates a coherent and articulated group of theories, methods, and procedures that predominantly characterize a phase of the evolution of a certain science. So even in science, the paradigm is not only heterogeneous, it includes theories, methods, and procedures, but it is also dynamic and subject to change. It's a phase of the evolution. So we don't have one paradigm, but several paradigms, and they change, and they shift in different phases, often coexisting. Why the paradigm? Because I used this word, I appropriated this word, and I started to consider it in what I call the paradigm minus then the Manhattan and Venice. And I felt it was my duty in a way to engage with the possibilities of the word. Here, I propose the urban spaces of Manhattan and Venice and their making as the paradigms of the making of the city that remain effective and continue to operate today beyond the historical categorization of modern city, medieval city. Categorization that I argue there are blind and produce the division and often blind the possibilities of certain histories. So the idea of the paradigm that I intended to suggest there produced an articulation of complexity of a case study beyond considering it as a formal model to imitate. It would make sense to imitate modern Manhattan or medieval Venice today. It was more the spatial and non-chronological intellectual short-circuiting of the two metropolitan conditions and spaces that enabled me to study and to concentrate on issues of density, combination of planning with piecemeal growth, regulated developments with creative interpretation and transgression, and on the division and intrusions which establish the conversation between two places that are apparently so different in geography, chronology, culture, historical conditions, scale, etc., etc. So the work in itself, focusing on both the specificity of the examples and the complexity of the operations that are very different that had produced them, crucially also attempted to establish between the two a relation, but not of the comparative or dialectical or exemplary nature. But how then? Manhattan and Venice were proposed here not as models to imitate, but as paradigms to consider in their specificity and differences. And placing the two in relation without comparisons and confrontations allowed for the activation of the space between them as paradigmatic. So the paradigmatic that I was proposing there was not offered by the two objects themselves, but by the relational space between the two, as established by the operations of the architectural decision. Also at play here, there was the issue of insularity, and that offered a combination of both natural and artificial boundaries meeting themselves. I isolated my case studies and produced a sort of a sampling, but also already immediately questioned the issue of the edges, of boundaries, of finitude, and the nature of their territory, and their opposition, and combination of solid and liquid, and separation of enclosures and connections. So in the end, what was relevant in this first approach for me was the redefinition of movement as a tension between that is always already embedded in the paradigmatic relation, to activate as a form of knowledge that is alternatives and maybe alternative and opens connections without the aiming to produce a general rule. Venice. All architects who study Venice always, at some point in their studies or career, come across an aphorism by Friedrich Nietzsche, which proposes a certain reading of Venice. I couldn't escape this, but what interested me here was the reading of Venice, or misreading of Venice, as an anticipation of the condition of isolation of the contemporary city, an image for the man of the future. Now, we have a few problems here. What Nietzsche does is to extract Venice from Venice. In a way, in the fragment, he presents a city that is divested by its cohesive and social dimension. Probably the first thing we could think of if considering that is this idea of the connective tissue of its physical body and social relations. Here, Venice is reduced to islands of what he calls solitudes. It's taken away, in a sense, from itself and is projected onto the contemporary metropolis, which means that Venice is simplified, reduced, removed from its original collective and cohesive nature, and turned into a paradigm for the metropolis. There is not a direct cause-effect relation between Venice and the city of the future, and then here I take the liberty of considering the city of the future in the aphorism, for instance, Manhattan or New York. So the operation is an intellectual association. Venice offers an image for the city of the future, and this is assumed by Nietzsche as paradigmatic of the metropolitan condition. What happens here is the paradigm opens up, it generates multiple possibilities and differences. Once we remove or dissolve the connective tissue of Venice, the solitudes are isolated, almost literally insulated. And Venice can become a condition and can be related to another future, which is both individual and universal, but not social. Venice, in other words, is rendered paradigmatic. Now, this intellectual operation that produces the image first defines the distance of the object from itself, remove the object from its singularity, Venice from Venice, and then returns it to another singularity, the city of the future, the man of the experience of the city of the man of the future. And this is exactly the operation of the paradigm as happens when it's activated by these prefixes, para and paradigm. It is only as a paradigm that Venice can be related to the metropolitan condition and indirectly to the Manhattan. It is the paradigmatic operation that moves from a singularity, Venice, to another singularity, Manhattan, working in the middle without generalization, deduction, abstraction of rules. The distancing performs not only the structural base from itself, but also from acquired historical, morphological, typological preconceptions and established specifications of the city that are normally used in architecture and urbanism. And so the paradigm is an operation makes it possible to perform this association, to relate events extracted from itself through simplification or complex connections, reduction to separate islands, etc., to the modern metropolis. This new proximity is not based on rules that define styles, prescribe forms, or frame histories, but lies instead in a series of operations that define the space of the two cities, and this may be perhaps Nietzsche's very lonely and isolated man of metropolitan solitudes. Now, in this operation, there are a few important points, and of course, I'll have to suggest that there are operations of the project. Isolation, decontextualization, definition of the singularity of the object examples as part of the paradigmatic operation. Yet they're not sufficient to activate the paradigm. The fundamental step for the activation of the paradigm is the exit of the object from itself. The paradigm is not the object, at least in this case the city, but the cultural construction that is produced around it, that movement of oscillation that does not follow a defined direction, but sets in motion and tension the object it addresses. So the paradigm here redefines and activates the object with and in its force field, and it changes and indeed is the force field. So maybe before attempting to marry these two possible definitions of paradigmatic operations in architecture, I think I need to try and understand the implication of this process by looking at other disciplines, linguistics, philosophy, and science. Let's start with science and try to produce three brief summaries of what I mean by that. 62, Thomas Kuhn's publishes The Structure of Scientific Revolutions, a text which will then receive a lot of responses and critiques, and he will return to it throughout his work and life, indeed. He is interested in explaining how knowledge is produced and how it changes in the sciences. For him, changes happen by revolutions rather than by accumulation or linear development of knowledge. He also suggests that it's impossible to give a linear account of such changes. As science is embedded in society and in a historical dimension, it is a cultural phenomenon, and as such, it can only be understood within the context of the culture of its time. And so he introduces, in this context, the idea of the paradigm to explain these changes. Far from monolithic bodies of laws or fixed rules, paradigms for Kuhn constitute those yet to define, in progress, bodies of knowledge that both define but are defined by a scientific community in a specific time. We have this constant round of negotiation. But what is a paradigm for Kuhn? And he will produce different definitions and they will continue to change, and that in itself is very interesting. But to maybe oversimplify, paradigms precede rules. They are wider and more flexible than rules. They are deeply contextualized cultural environment that encompass rules, identify and determine research directions, and identify and connect research communities. Every time I read this, of course, I think, instead of science, I think architecture, but that's my professional information, but I hope you have the same. So there is this notion of collective agreement and participation and the relational nature that are always already implied in the idea of the paradigm, the scientific one for Kuhn, maybe for us as well. And this is a very important step in Kuhn's definition of the paradigm, because it opens the possibility of a research without rules, a research that is happening as long as there is a shared recognition of common achievement. The paradigm does not prescribe definite rules, but enables dialogue, means dialogue, collaboration, participation, confrontational ideas. And it will then be the prevalence of the confrontation that will give rise to criticism of the established paradigm, and the established paradigm maybe will allow for the emergence of a new one. Just to give you some direct quotes, the paradigm tells the scientist about the entities that nature does and does not contain. But interestingly, the information provides a map whose details are elucidated by mature scientific research. I don't know how good you are at orientation, but a map is open and welcoming. So as a map, the paradigm is a tool that both informs but also remains open and requires interpretation, additions, updates, but, and I'm going back to Kuhn's words, and I quote, paradigms provide scientists not only with a map, but also with some of the directions essential for map making. In learning a paradigm, a scientist acquires theory, methods, and standards together, usually in inextricable mixtures. And then Kuhn gives us the example of the fact that the shared example of the paradigm enables us to learn something before the law is established. A learning that is not acquired by exclusively verbal means, and that is also very important in architecture, because it's given together with concrete examples and how they work, etc. Nature and words are learned together. So this is a fundamental statement for the definition of the paradigm as a non-verbal and non-rule-based form of knowledge. Another form of knowledge embedded in what it calls shared exemplars. But it is, and I'm quoting him again, not less systematic or less analyzable than knowledge embedded in rules, laws, or criteria of identification. At this point, he also recurs to a grammatical reference to explain the difference between the idea of scientific paradigm that he proposes and the established notion of paradigm. In a way, he makes paradigm of grammar himself. And he very simply, maybe it's easier if I show it to you, he distinguishes between the established usage of the paradigm in grammar as an accepted model or pattern and the move away from replication that he proposes for the scientific paradigm. I'm not going to read you the quote, but the idea is that the rule always already contains within itself the possibility of variation. So there is an oscillation in the paradigmatic that enables variation, includes exceptions, and allows for spaces of mediation. And this is made clear 10 years later, after the publication of Kuhn's work, when Roland Barthes tackles, indeed attacking, the idea of the linguistic paradigm in his work. I have to warn you that the connection is made by me, not because Barthes writes in any way referring to or responding to Kuhn's work. Of course, the fact that these things happen quite close in time are themselves revealing of some cultural, scientific, and intellectual context. What Hollenbach does is to, it's actually a series of lectures he holds in Paris, and much later they're translated in Paris as such. They're not anything, they're really like lecture notes in English as well. Also because, as we will see, the neutral cannot be defined, and therefore can only be approached in fragments. The neutral, should be with a capital N perhaps, that Barth proposes is, in his definition, the anti-paradigm. But we need to see what the anti-paradigm is. It's a form of knowledge, again, alternative to dialectical oppositions and exclusions. Rosalind Krauss and Denis Lier have written the introduction to the translation, and they explain, and I quote, that language always demands a choice, an identification of gender, person, the desire for one or the other of two opposed values. The oppositions structure linguistics terms binaries, and semiology calls paradigm. That is what Barth, with the neutral, is opposing or trying to dismantle. Krauss and Ollier continue, meaning is generated by friction of one binary element against the other, which forms the fundamental oppositions, and such oppositions leave the unchosen all implicit within any speech act. It is this friction, or the space of this friction, that interests Barth. He's fascinated by the friction, by the fact that even having to choose between the binary, masculine, feminine, black, white, whatever decision, present, future, etc., in language leaves a trace. And the trace and the friction are absolutely the space that the neutral occupies and activates. I define the neutral, he writes, or rather lectures first, as that which outplays the paradigm. Or rather, I call neutral everything that baffles the paradigm. I'm not trying to define the word, I'm trying to make the thing I gather under a name. That's all you can do. Can't define the neutral, it can only be gathered around. It is the anti-paradigm, it is anti the opposition of two terms, etc. Of course, for me, his neutral as anti-paradigm is what my paradigm is, but then I need to perhaps explain a bit better or more. If meaning rests on conflict and choice, Barth argues, all conflict is generative of meaning. To choose one and refuse the other is always a sacrifice made to meaning, to produce meaning, to offer it to be consumed. And instead, he wants to occupy what he calls this polymorphous field of the paradigm of conflict avoidance equals, he writes, the neutral. So the neutral becomes a whole field of investigation to define alternative forms of knowledge and communication that are not necessarily based on language, that are not based on choice between two mutually defeating opposites, and attempt to define and produce meaning in a different way, in this space in between. The neutral is what baffles the paradigm. But the neutral doesn't mean confusion, imprecision, or indifference. It is, for Barth, what he calls a strong activity, a commitment. The neutral doesn't refer to impressions, grayness, neutrality, or indifference. My neutral, he says, can refer to tense, strong, unprecedented styles. It's a difficult burning activity to outplay the panel. Nor is the neutral the silence, because the silence will produce another absolute opposed to speech. And here things start becoming interesting, because the neutral is not silence, and it tries also to outplay silence as well. Silence is excluded as a possibility. The neutral cannot oppose speech with silence, with another absolute. It can only be defined, and I'm quoting, by minimal expenditure of speech act meant to neutralize silence as a sign. But what is this minimal expenditure of speech, this occupation of a space of fashion of opposites? Is the neutral the game the neutral plays that keeps at play opposites without ever resolving them? And is it therefore exhausting but never exhaustive as an activity? Is it a never-ending project that enables possibilities but never decides? Now, if we think of architecture in this context, and of the project of architecture as enabled and defined by a moment of decision which we need to perform, is the neutral the process that leads to it? The process of design, of options and different solutions, all kept at play and consideration before the decision that moves from process to project, from design to building. In other words, can we think of the neutral as the design process? Is the neutral the trigger moment of resistance before this becomes organized? Barthes' neutral is openly identified by him with the conflictual. It's a non-neutral neutral. It's active, inventive. It offers possibilities to overcome the conflictual, but not through suspension, abstention, abolition, but through the invention of another, the third complex, not zero neutral. It is, I think, yes, one of the linguistic tools of non-arrogance, of non-intolerance. And at this point, he develops this idea of diversity, of non-intolerance. And he looks at the, again, the etymology of the neutral. Forgive my Greek, to or deuteron, neither one or the other, the political neutral, the one that links on no sides, the mesos, the middle. But what is more interesting in is the third, what he says, more interesting word that relates to the neutral. It's the heteroclitus, which in grammar indicates the irregular words, the words whose declension proceeds from different themes, irregular words, irregular verbs. The irregular, the unforeseeable, of one that follows the other without order, which proposes a version of the neutral far from silence, exemption, cancellation, but produces a scramble through a revolving sequence both disturbed and disturbing. So this neutral is not neutral, it's not static, it's not balanced, it's not in the middle. It's dynamic, it's unstable, it oscillates. And I would like to suggest that the neutral as proposed and redefined by Barthes, in fact, performs what I have been calling the paradigm, or the operation of the paradigm, as an alternative possibility that works between opposition and in the space of this difference. So Barthes' definition, or he prefers to call it desire for the neutral, in fact opens up the possibility to redefine the paradigm. And then we need to further explore the paradigm and its operation. So very good. The knowability of the paradigm is never presupposed, and its specific operation consists in suspending and deactivating its empirical givenness in order to exhibit only an intelligibility. George Agamben again in his essay, What is the Paradigm? And here Agamben gives us a comprehensive history, or let's say critical history, of the notion of the paradigm in Western philosophical and scientific thought. He refers initially to the idea of the paradigm in Thomas Kuhn, and then moves to philosophy and to look at the origin of the term and the variations, trying to open the space, let's say, between the example and the paradigm. For Agamben, there is an important shift in the reconsideration of the paradigm as productive of knowledge. He says the universal logic of the law here is replaced by the specific and singular logic of example, not example itself, but its operations. And here he discusses that distancing process that I showed earlier with the idea of Venice and the appropriation of Nietzsche's aphorism. It definitely does it much better than me to, this is the book if you're interested, to explain that paradigms obey not to the logic of the metaphorical transport meaning, but the analogical logic of the example. More keen to allegory than metaphor, the paradigm is a singular case that is isolated from its context. Only insofar as by exhibiting its own singularity it makes intellectual a new ensemble whose homogeneity it itself constitutes. It is the term functioning as a paradigm is deactivated from its normal use. Without the separation of the thing from itself and its activation, the paradigm is not a paradigm. Only then can be moved not to another context but to inform that which cannot be shown in any other way. We're talking here about a form of intervention or production of knowledge that is not alternative to that of the logical but coexists with it. So the paradigm is made more, is made paradigmatic in a specific context, and that is very important, when the process of its isolation assumes it as a paradigm, makes it a paradigm. And more than the object itself, the paradigm then becomes this process of the showing that takes place if the object is removed from its context, but more importantly from itself and its specificity. Isolation, decontextualization, definition of singularity, then the example object can become a paradigm. And you're still seeing it, but I'm not seeing it. It's just that I see it. So I'm talking about it. The paradigm is a cultural operation works towards the production of a non-dialectical form of knowledge. It does not aim to achieve the universal and derived principles and rules from it. It occupies another space, that of analogy. Agamben quotes, and it's quite interesting actually to read this embedded. Because it traces it back to Aristotle. And this is Aristotle, and I quote, and if we're lucky, we get it also on the screen. The paradigm does not function as a part with respect to the whole, nor as a whole with respect to the part, but as a part with respect to the part. If both are under the same, but one is better known than the other. I've been told that not all of you are architects, but if you are, this is absolutely contrary to what Rembrandtista Alberti taught us, and the idea of architecture as proportional and harmonic, where the parts and the whole come together. This is another way of thinking the relations of part and part, which does not even try or pretend to produce a whole. From this, Agamben derives that why induction from the particular to the universal and deduction from the universal to the particular, the paradigm instead is defined by a third and paradoxical type of movement. It goes from the particular to the particular. The example here constitutes a peculiar form of knowledge that does not proceed by articulating together the universal and the particular, but seems to dwell on the plane of the latter, the particular. And here, the operation of the particular and the paradigm is associated to the analogy. And I'm slowly coming to architecture and its use of it. Agamben is interested in how the paradigm produces knowledge. How, he asks, how can a paradigm, which is a singularity, create a new analogical context, new generality? And he observes, we have to first neutralize traditional philosophical positions, such as universal, in particular, general, individual, and even also form and content. And again, if you even if you're not architect, you know that form follows function, and the idea of function and form were the key rules of modernist architecture. So here, within a couple of sentences or paragraphs, I have attacked Renaissance and modernism. So what are we going to do now in the presence of our contemporary city? Its tertium datum, this is Agamben again, is stubborn, neither A nor B, not to take them up into a higher synthesis, but to transform them into a force field, transverse by polar tension. Now, force field and polar tension, the idea of the electromagnetic field and this idea of evaporation of identities is something that's very often not appropriated from this discourse, but used in the analysis or attempts to understand the city and the contemporary city. It's interesting that even in Agamben's work, things start to become spatial and architectural. And this is absolutely not the first time that philosophy resorts to the spatial, the architectural, to explain or to argue contents. But so let's look at this spatially. Again, we've seen the isolation, decontextualization, definition of singularity, the object examples, then are still not sufficient to activate this paradigm. The fundamental step is that the paradigm is activated by making the object exit from itself. The paradigm is not an object, but the cultural construction that is produced around the object. And the movement of oscillation does not follow a defined direction, but it sets the object in motion, this tension, in this magnetic field. The operation is spatial. It defines the activation of the object with and in a force field. Let's call it a context. It is indeed the activation of this force field. So semiologically, the paradigm defined in this way actually operates like the neutral Roland Barthes has defined as the anti-paradigma shape. At this point, having redefined the paradigm, Agamben suggests that it is the analogical third that produces this neutralization. It doesn't refer to Barthes, but it talks about neutralization and indiscernibility activated in a vectorial force field of vectorial intensities, and here they are. So even if the two discourses don't directly touch one another, strangely enough, we have the recurrence of these terms, which seem to bounce in and out of the discourse. So like Barthes' neutral, Agamben's paradigm slips away from the logic of language and even from the attempts to define it, from singularity to singularity, without ever leaving singularity, I'm quoting Agamben here. It transforms every singular case into an exemplar of a general rule that can never be stated a priori. Can we call this a project? This is my question. Can we call this a project? Agamben does not talk about Barthes or refers to his work, but he looks at Plato. And again, if we suspend for a moment attention towards the resolution of the idea in Plato, and we instead focus on what Plato defines as a paradigm, we have that, and I'm paraphrasing, paradigm is not a given object or a pre-existing likeness, but it is produced, and these are Plato's words, or so they believe, in translation, by placing alongside, conjoining together, and above all, by showing and exposing. Placing alongside, conjoining together, showing and exposing. And then Agamben again makes reference to the grammatical example of declensions. In this case, more the declension of nouns rather than verbs, but again to suggest the possibility of the exception, but the exception already embedded in the rule. So to sort of not force them together, but to sum them up, in part the grammatical neutral indicates the heteroclite, the irregularly declined. That is the exception in the rule. In Agamben, instead, the exclusion of the included, when rose becomes paradigm for the declension in rosa, rosa, etc., suggests the mirror of the inclusion of the excluded. Can we think of architecture as paradigm? Or as performing a paradigmatic and relational operation? The paradigm in Agamben performs through analogy, oscillation between general and particular, suspensions of particularity, and without referring to an arche, the origin. Is it possible then to think of the paradigmatic operation defined in this way in relation to the working of the architectural project? Or in other words, to think of architecture as paradigm. The project of architecture as it continues to happen and remake itself, produces a form of knowledge that combines both practices of induction and deduction. But the project of architecture as operation is not and cannot be oppositional. The project, in its complexity, must hold together differences and opposites, keep them at play, produce instances of it closed temporarily and then reopen. And then the question is here, how does architecture learn from architecture if it's not by rules and law? And more precisely, how does architecture learn to make architecture? Of course, I don't have a definitive answer, but I have an attempt to tackle this. Historically, the discourse on architectural production of knowledge revolved, as we know, around imitation. And even here, we have problems, because imitation of nature, imitation of architectural models, all the way to the production of typologies. When we speak of typology in architecture today, we usually implicitly refer to the modernist idea of typology, form, forms, function, and separation of function that it proposes. But we need to look back. I'm sorry for all this zooming in and out and gymnastics back and forth. But before modernist typology, even beyond the Illuminist catalogues of typologies, we really need to look back and in a much wider term at the notion of type of typology. It was amazingly developed and defined by architectural theorists of the Enlightenment. So the idea of a current fluid, recombinable, and yet precise arrangement of the non-denominator, the irregular, unforeseeable that Bart would call the reinvention, maybe can be traced back to the concept of type of the theory of enlightenment and its potentials for re-elaboration and only partial adhesion to issues of function. 1825. Antoine Chrysostome Quatremer de Quincy writes the Dictionary of Architecture part for the Encyclopedia Judique. And he offers here an incredibly modern, not modernist, definition of type. And we continue to reconsider it and critically discuss it today. His type has no form. And it is without a predefined function. And he says that all is more or less vague in time. The time is the nucleus for a complexity of spatial arrangements adaptable to a function, but not generated by function. And so this type is not a static form, but a multiplicity of variations where time operates in time, like a sort of nucleus about which are collected and to which are coordinated in time the developments and variations of forms to which the object is susceptible. 1825, on now. And this is extraordinary because it's a non-definition of space. And it offers time as a sort of a dynamic four-dimensional protoform that it's at the same time original and generative, but also derivative and cumulative, because as it generates, it transforms itself. And so today, the suppression of the functionalist typology calls for, instead, a flexible tool that is not only afunctional, but also informative, rather than formed and formal. And this type cannot be represented as a form, but only as an idea, but it's not the idea of pleasure, it's not the idea of the before. It's an idea that continues to be approximated and maybe reached, but never quite reached, because it transformed in the process of trying to approximate. It's a form in constant modification, molded according to the occasion, it says, to perform as critical agents. It works in a context. And it's the vagueness of this type that questions the stability of form and opens the classical language of architecture to this oscillation of the multiple. The interesting thing is that this definition, or this aspect of this definition, is sort of conveniently forgotten or ignored well into the early 19th, into the 20th century. And so we need to wait until after modernism and the first responses that anticipate post-modernism return of attention to this. And this is Aldo Rossi, who writes in the 60s, and he produces this incredibly interesting idea of logic rationalism. And in the logic rationalism is not logic and it's not rational. Let's see what he says. He's very interested in what Emil Kaufmann, the historian, had called the revolutionary architect. Rossi writes particularly about Boulet. He designs in relation to Boulet. He's interested in the research on form, which is separated from the idea of the function. And therefore, he uses the idea of logic rationally. It recognizes the efficiency of the mediocrity offered by the results achieved only in a rational way, and raises the demand to break the rational construction from within, posing a continuous contradiction between the system of principle and the personal expression. What we have here is not a self-destructive rational, but a self-critical rationalism. Which allows him to question the outcomes of rationalism. It is free to work in and through contradictions without aiming or claiming to offer one resolution, but allowing the contradiction and the contradicting forces to inhabit the project. For Rossi, it is the personal dimension that allows to break this sort of standstill, so that the logic rationalism, almost paradoxically, is actually enabled by memories, by feelings, by personal histories, but not only personal of the individual, but of the collective, and that will take him back to the situation. So the personal dimension for Rossi is the decisional moment in the project and on the project. And that allows him to break this rational opposition and ultimately to make the project happen, to be. And again here, we see the project at work in the space in between of dialectical oppositions, what Barthes would have called the friction, inhabited by traces. To this end, Rossi's theorizes and employs analogy, populating his project with a sort of a private mantra of architectural education, personal memories. And then the combinatory proliferation combined in this architectural imaginary of this, in a way, subjective poetics. It is this that he calls analogical, opposing it to a form of thought expressible only in words and through the dialectical construction of speech. Here, Rossi is not making things up. Again, he needs to go out of architecture, and actually the definition of the analogical that he performs in his projects is the definition of Carl Jung's idea of analogical thought. Thought which is archaic, unexpressed, practically inexpressible in words. And is opposed, I'm quoting here, to logical thought that is instead expressed in words and directed to the outside world in the form of discourse. And what interestingly Rossi does here is to claim for architecture this area, this part, this kind of knowledge that is not verbal, that is not rational, but that it is other and it cannot be expressed in words. It's almost like the silent, non-silent of art. And therefore the need to operate, in this case, through images and representation that both anticipate spaces but also anticipate impossibilities of space. And these are just some of the examples of his work and how uses them to then generate the project. Manfredo fully writes about Rossi's work, and he observes that the early architectural project in both his design and his writings and theory perform a search for form through a work of what Tofuri calls critical work internal to architecture, is this self-criticality. And there's this sense of estrangement, silence, abstraction, normal suspension of life in the early projects. It's almost a stubborn construction through architecture of this enforced distance, which is necessary to the operation, for the project to then become a critical act, literally in this case, a critical piece in the city. Later projects, Tafuri is quite critical of, so much so that then the polemical exchanges of the two become part of their publications and public exchanges. There's the idea of the assassination. But interesting, having distilled his analogical language, it's only in the 80s that Rossi produces the collaborative drawing and collage of the analogical city. So what is this analogical clue, almost, provided by Rossi to read this project? He deploys the analogical to escape the categorical distinctions predicated by the logical, so his logical rational is absolutely far from the strictly logical, and opens a space for an action that does not work by oppositions or by synthetic resolution, but assembles, disassembles, recomposes, decomposes, and does not reach or aim to reach a stable synthesis. And here again we have the reference to the analogical thought in Newman, that which operates across the gaps of unspoken censorship. And it is this approach that allows Rossi to move from the architectural object of his earlier projects to a complex, from what he calls manufacto, the artifact, the object as a process, as an outcome of design, to a consideration of the city as a system of relations and collective association, but not of structured ones. And with this move, Rossi's introduces and returns to the idea of the architecture of the city he had theorized, but only in writing, about 20 years earlier, before this, as an architecture of multiple authorship, collective memory, as the project of the city, as a process in time. So why am I showing you this? I don't want to suggest that Rossi's collage and drawing from 40 years ago offers a solution for contemporary architecture of the city. But what this image and this project does, the analogical city shows a process that takes place in the project of architecture as a way for the project to move away from the distinctions of modernism, from the articulations of urban morphology, from the oppositions of the dialectical architecture, and propose and practice what he had called logical rationalism. And it is this kind that Rossi proposes that can only be articulated through a project that is set free, that can offer an alternative to linguistics, dialectics, and perform perhaps paradigmatic, predefined paradigmatic operations. So the analogical city, then maybe beyond the image itself, is interesting because of what it does. It exposes and enacts how architectural work, or might more, in an architecture that works in a tension space between distinction, dichotomies, oppositions. So maybe architecture can be a paradigm. It is paradigm if paradigm is redefined, as I have attempted to do, not as an object or as a room, but as an operation that is not predefined, but proceeds ad hoc through repetitions, changes that the project, only the project, can produce each time architecture becomes architecture. And so paradigm is a series of operations, oscillation, as a third element in the dialectical process, not as a mediation or solution, but as a further issue that allows for a reconfiguration and complication of the problem, and for the removal of rigid frameworks. And thus, redefining the paradigm requires a continuous adjustment of perspective and of its vocabulary, sort of navigation that embraces and inhabits contradictions. I'm trying here to make a summary of this non-definition. We have the non-prescriptive rule as a merging agreement and constellation of beliefs, as a non-normative relation between singularity and singularity, and as a dynamic problem. And this would be the paradigm in science, as defined by. We have the neutral as something in the middle, but as a third possibility that breaks into that middle and interferes, it plays or outplays with the dialectical and gathers and opens to otherness in the neutral as breaking of the paradigm of semiology. We have the paradigm as a dynamic production of knowledge, alternative to discourse and language, that does not proceed from pre-established rules, but moves from a particular to a particular in a non-deductive, non-inductive way as an irreducible singularity that works through analogy in philosophy. We have the architectural type as a fluid and recombinable nucleus of aggregation of possible variations that oscillate around form in architecture. And again, in architecture, in Gross's work, we have logical rationalism as a third element between normative systems and personal expression that breaks the rational construction from within and its analogical project as a key to a collective process. So all these apparently contradictory terms here form and enter into a tension field of relations in which they are mutually challenged and redefined towards, I hope, a redefinition, or rather an activation of the paradigm as an open operation of the relational architecture. So architecture as a paradigm is a modus operandi. It's a dynamic action that contains within itself possibility of variation, movement, oscillation, multiplicity. It does not work only on the objects that it produces and treats as paradigms. Also, more importantly, it performs what I call the paradigmatic operation in the space in between. The space of the city then escapes dialectical definitions, and it becomes the space par excellence for these experiments, where contrasts are occupied and take place, literally, rather than being dialectically resolved. And the space changes, and its configurations are never final and definitive. So maybe architecture is a paradigm apart from anything to be imitated or rigid, works in this context in a way that is always tentative, partial, at play with forces that it cannot control and can only partially represent and with which it can interfere. Paradigm invites to rethink architecture as a gradual process of adaptation, as the making of a dense space that is constantly transforming, as the making without a predefined figure that allows for and invites the incorporation of and adaptation to other languages and knowledges.